So I was just living this life of quiet desperation in a job I hated, thinking, what am I going to do? And but around this time, I started to know a little more about how TV worked and movies worked and who wrote these things. And I started to become more of a fan. It was actually the summer of '76 when I saw Taxi Driver. That was the thing that actually made me start thinking about movies in a different way. So I actually was like, who made this movie? And what? So I knew about directors and TV, and I knew a little about people, how they wrote TV shows, but I still was not quite ready to take that leap and say I wanted to do this. And it wasn't until I became so miserable as an attorney, and I finally realized this is going to be your life. You're going to be one of these guys who is going to look back when you're 70 years old and say, I wonder what would have happened if I took this shot. And I finally said, all right, I got to do something else. And it was pretty clear to everybody, even the people I worked with at the law firm, this is not who you are. And I said, I'm never going to be good at this. I don't care. I would get on the phone and argue with lawyers. They would argue with me about who owns what money. And I was like, how do you get up to even pretend that you give a shit about this? I just give him the money. It's like, that's like not what you want your lawyer to be like. It's like, you want somebody to win that fight. It's like, it's not my money. Just come on. You're some old lady. Just let her have it, So that's really, I was just not cut out for this. So I finally said to myself, what do you want to do when you wake up in the morning? And I thought, well, advertising is interesting. That's kind of creative. Maybe I could do that. And then this little voice was like, it's not advertising. And I said, well, sales, because I like to talk to people. I said, it's not sales. What is it? What do you want to do? Money's off the table. Forget about the money. When you wake up, how do you want to spend your day? And I said to myself, I want to write sitcoms. I want to be a sitcom writer. And once I was able to say that out loud, it was like the heavens opened up, and it was like, okay, that's what you want. That's real. I was 29. I mean, psychologists would have a field day with this. I mean, I'm right at the age when people do this. And I start thinking, all right, how do I make this happen? So first I said, well, all right, I'm not really sure if I'm funny. I think I am. I'm funny with my friends, my family, and my very limited circle. But the quickest way to find out if you're funny is go do stand-up. Go try that. And I signed up for a comedy course taught by this guy Scott Blakeman. I think he actually still teaches it. He's a working stand-up comic, and it was like the learning annex. And basically, you go to a few classes, and the idea is you develop on your own like a 5-minute stand-up set, and then you do open mic night at the Comic Strip on Third Avenue. And I said, all right, well, this is going to answer a lot of questions for me. And I did it, and I had a pretty decent set. I wrote jokes, and people laughed, and it was, I said, all right, I can do this. So I didn't really have an ambition to be a performer, but I just wanted to see if I wrote something, is the right thing happening?
Do you remember
And
the best joke that you did?
it wasn't really jokes. It was more storytelling. It was more like Woody Allen-ish kind of, if you remember, his stuff from the 60s. Or these long kind of rambling kind of stories. So, and I don't really, actually, I really don't remember what it was. But I remember it definitely got the reaction I had hoped for. So I said, all right, I can do this. Now, right around this time too, my mom dies, and also psychologically, the bonds of that restriction I felt of like you've got to be successful and a lawyer and all this other stuff. It wasn't that I didn't have to prove anything to anybody anymore, and that was I didn't realize how large she loomed in my life in terms of the psychology of wanting to be important or wanting to be successful and what that meant. It was being successful on her terms as opposed to what I wanted to do, which would be more, be an artist. So once that was off the table too, I was like, I didn't. It didn't matter if anyone thought I was crazy for leaving New York, and they did. Even my closest friends and family, I said, all right, this is what I'm going to do. And people were saying, all right, wait a minute. You grow up, you go to automotive high school, you graduate from that, you get into NYU, which is unbelievable. You're the first person in your family to really go to college. You graduate from NYU, you get into law school. You're on partnership track in a major Manhattan law firm. You're going to quit that. You're going to move to Los Angeles, where you've never been. And you're going to start writing scripts which you've never written. That's your plan. And I said, yeah, and I know I'm right. I know this is my destiny. This is the right thing for me.